Hare Krishna, thank you for coming today evening, and we'll continue our discussion on when bad things happen to good people, how do good people respond? So I talked about how this is the recurring theme of the Srimad Bhagavatam. Yesterday I discussed about how right from Parikshit Maharaj, who was cursed to die for some minor mistake, to Dhruva, who was grievously insulted for a simple desire natural to a child, for Prahlad, who was threatened to death, and ultimately for the gopis, who were rejected by God after they had rejected everything for God. So this theme is meant to reassure Parikshit Maharaj that you are not alone in suffering, and in that way, to empower him to get rid of feelings of resentment or self-pity and focus devotionally on the Lord. So I talked about how this pastime of Vamana and Bali Maharaj is especially extraordinary, because Bali Maharaj had so much to lose. The priest who had restored him to life, who had provided him glory, universal rule, he rejected that priest to satisfy an unknown Brahmin to give him charity. So normally, when we do something good at great cost to ourselves, the very least that we expect is that at least get some appreciation. But at that time, if we get condemnation, then it's extremely difficult to accept that. It's if we do a lot for someone and they don't even thank us, we'll feel bad. But if instead of thanking us, they attack us, they hurt us, that's even worse. What is the difference between a man and a dog? It says dog is grateful. Yes. If you feed the dog won't bite your hand. But among human beings, there's no guarantee. I saw a car bumper sticker. It said, "The more I get to know people, the more I love my dog." So, sometimes people can betray us. It can be very painful. But if it is God who seems to betray us, then how do you deal with that? How do you process that? So, that is what is about to happen. For Bali Maharaj, he said that yes, ask for as much charity as you want. At that time, Vamana said that, yeah, I just want 3 steps. And then he said, no, take more. He said, no, I just want 3 steps. I am content. And he said, okay, if that's what you want. And then although Shukracharya forbade him, Bali did not follow Shukracharya. And he stuck to truthfulness. So, the teacher is important, but more important than the teacher is the teaching. The teacher's value comes because of the teaching. So here, Bali Maharaj had to choose between the teacher and the teacher. A Brahmana is supposed to teach truthfulness and virtue. And normally, the teacher helps us to choose the teaching. But to have to choose between the teacher and the teaching, it's a very difficult choice. And he chooses the teaching. He says, no, I will be truthful. I will honor my word. And when he does so, exactly what Shukracharya has predicted happens. When he offers those, he says, yes, please take whatever charity you want. And then immediately, Lord Vamana becomes Trivikrama. He's a dwarf, but he becomes so large that just by 1 foot, one of his feet, he covers the earth. With the other foot, he covers the expanse of the universe. And then he says, oh Bali, you promised me 3 steps of land, but with 2, everything that you own is over. Will you dishonor your word now? How will you fulfill your promise? So, at this point, what has happened? Lord Vamana, now it's significant that among all the, that's okay. Is done? Okay. Thank you. So, Lord Vamana is a dwarf. Now, a dwarf is somebody who is of a size less than normal. And from that size, he becomes not only greater than normal, he becomes greater than everything else. So sometimes some people ask, that why do you worship God in a form? Now God is unlimited. Why do you limit him by giving him a form? It's not that we give God a form. If you say that God doesn't have a form, that is also limiting God. That form is extremely attractive in this world. And if something which is so attractive in this world is something which God is bereft of, then the creator becomes lesser than the creation. And that doesn't make any sense. So God's unlimitedness does not mean that he can't have a form. God's unlimitedness means that he can have a limited seeming form and still not be limited by that form. His unlimitedness is that he can have a limited seeming form. He's just at one place. But at his will, that limited form can become unlimited. So we see this in the universal form of Krishna also, that although Krishna was one person within the universe, at the next moment, the universe was within him. So even when he was within the universe was within him. So God's unlimitedness is not that he doesn't have a form, but rather he is not limited by his form. And for the purpose of reciprocating love with those devoted to him, he manifests a form when necessary. He eternally has a form in his abode, but he also manifests the unlimitedness of his potency and form whenever necessary. That's what he does over here. And at this time, seeing this huge, magnificent form, the whole universe is stunned. The gods in the heavens start offering prayers to this magnificent, universally pervasive being. And it is, the Ganga starts flowing because his feet penetrate the universal coverings. And the whole universe becomes sanctified by seeing this form. But here, then that giant form of Trivikrama, Vikrama means some extraordinary activity, Vikrama, heroic activity. Trivikrama means the one who takes three heroic steps, the two steps that cover the whole universe. At that time, he turns towards Bali and he says, you had promised me three steps, where is the third step now? And then Bali says, oh my Lord, I will never dishonor my word. Although you have tricked me by expanding yourself to such a big size, I will not trick you. I will honor you, honor my word. And he says, please place your third foot on my head. And he bows down. And the Lord places his foot on his head. And at this point, the whole story goes in a quite complicated way. But let's focus on two main points. Bali Maharaj's servants, the demons who are assisting him, they become infuriated and they say, this is cheating. And they say that our king is bound by the codes of a yajman, of a person performing sacrifice, that they are not meant to shed blood, they are not meant to fight. So therefore, he can't resist, but we will. And they try to attack. This happens before Bali Maharaj offers his third step. So at that time, when Bali Maharaj has to think, what do I do now? when the two steps are covered. So at that time, because he's failed to honor his word, he gets arrested and bound like a prisoner by the pasha, by the noose of celestial beings. And the gods celebrate because their enemy has been bested now, has been tricked. But his servants are angry. And they try to attack this Trivikrama, this giant form. But immediately the Vishnu does repel them. And they start routing them. So at that time, Bali Maharaj says, don't fight. The time now is unfavorable for us. And when the time is unfavorable, no matter what we do, it will backfire. So he says, just wait. Let go, don't fight. They reluctantly agree, not because they want to listen to his instructions, but because they realize they are no match to the Vishnu also. And then at that time, various celestial beings start offering prayers. Brahmaji comes and offers prayers and he says, my dear Lord, you are satisfied even by offering a little drop of water to you, a little glass of water, a single leaf, a single flower. Even that offered with devotion satisfies you. And this King Bali has offered everything to you. So please be satisfied. And then he says that the Prahlad Maharaj comes. And Prahlad Maharaj says, and this is his own grandson. And Prahlad's prayers are very revealing. Prahlad says, my dear Lord, for those who are attached to wealth, that attachment opens the doors to the darkest regions of hell. It is commonly said, it is attributed that Jesus said that wealth is the cause of all evil. But actually what he said is, love of wealth is the cause of all evil. Wealth is a functional necessity. As artha becomes anartha when we make it our paramartha. Paramartha is our supreme purpose. When we make money our supreme purpose, then it starts working against us. Anartha is that which hurts us, that which is valueless, that which is meaningless. So when we make artha into paramartha, then it becomes anartha. So at this point, what happens? Bali Maharaj says that Prahlad Maharaj says that Bali was attached to wealth. And therefore, you, in order to free him from that attachment, have taken away all his wealth. And your ways are inconceivable, O Lord. And he also requests the Lord to please overlook his faults. And then, after all these prayers are offered, Bali says, so there is, inside the demons try to help Bali, the devatas also try to help Bali, the celestial beings, the godly beings also try to help Bali. And still the Lord remains, at least externally, unrelenting. And then, see, ultimately, what the Lord wants is not our wealth, not our possessions. The Lord wants our heart. And at that time, Bali Maharaj says that, he offers a prayer to the Lord and he says, my dear Lord, different people punish their different dependence in different ways. And it is always for their well-being. A parent may punish their child. A teacher may punish a student. The police may punish a wrongdoer. But in the history of the world, no one has punished anyone the way you have punished. And interestingly, he doesn't say just how unfair you are. He says, this is how unparalleled you are. The kind of mercy, he doesn't consider this to be atrocity. He says, what you have done is unprecedented and I accept it. And then he says, I offer you my third step. So, here what is going on? When he offers the third step, the Lord puts his foot on his head. And when he puts his foot on his head, he is pushed down from the heavens to a lower level of existence. But that lower level is actually not lower. It is called Sutala. It is a level of existence which is like among the lower levels, it is a higher, it is like a heavenly place. And not only does the Lord send him there, so Lord Vamana, now that Bali has been sent back from the heavens, which he had conquered, sent out of the heavens, then the heavens are handed over to Indra. And Indra is happy. And Indra says that, oh, you, Vamana, you, because he again now becomes a dwar. So he says, you are now
Upendra.
He says, you are like the younger brother of Indra. You have done me such a great favor. Now, Vamana also appears from the same mother, Aditi, as Indra appears. And because he appears later, so he says, Upendra. Now, Upendra in English will mean up Indra. You know, he is above Indra. But he thinks he is below. Because you are a younger brother. But he's out of the scale of any comparison within the existence. But after that, it's very significant. Then that Lord Upendra, Lord Vamana, he gives the heavens to Indra. And then he gives himself to Bali. He goes to Sutala and he is so indebted to Bali for the surrender that he has shown. But he says, I will give myself to you. I will become your doorkeeper. Now, why the doorkeeper of all things? The significance is that the doorkeeper is one who guards, who restricts entry, who prevents intruders from coming in. He said that I took the whole kingdom away, I took everything away from you, but I will ensure that now onward, nobody will be able to take anything from you. So in this way, the Lord becomes his servant, his guard. And in that way, the Lord offers him everything. He offers himself to him. This is the sweetness of the Lord. Now, so there are times when the Lord gives we desire something and then we get that. We think, oh, God is so kind, he gave me what we desired. And in this case, the Lord does that for Indra. Indra desires a kingdom and the Lord gives that kingdom to him. But with respect to Bali, the Lord takes away everything from him. But why did the Lord take away everything? So that he can give himself. Give himself means that in the world, as long as we want anything other than God, we can't have God. It's like a mother is doing some work at home and the baby starts crying. Now, mothers as they grow up, they also know the different ways the baby cries. If the baby is crying just because she wants attention, or the baby is crying because she needs something, and if the baby is crying just because she needs attention, the mother might come and give a little toy and go back. And then the baby is happy and keeps playing with the toy. And afterwards, she gets bored with the toy and she again starts crying. Then the mother may come and give another toy. Baby is happy and he calls. And the mother goes away again. So like that, the mother keeps giving toys to the baby. But then, if the mother gives a toy to the baby, and the baby still keeps crying. The mother gives another toy and the baby still keeps crying. And the mother says, what do you want? She says, I want you. And then the mother will pick up the baby, hold her to her bosom, and hug her and shower her with her love. So similarly for us, we are always needy in the material world. We always feel incomplete. We always feel, I need this, I need that, I need that. And God sometimes acts like a parent, like a mother. Okay, you need this, take this. You need this, take this. It may not come instantly, but it comes. And we get it, and if we become satisfied with it, then we will get it, and God will no longer be an active presence in our lives, at least not an experienced presence in our lives. But sometimes, when we refuse to take the alternatives, take the worldly things, which are often like toys, which God is offering us, when we refuse to take those, That is when God gives Himself to us. And for that purpose, we need to say no. And sometimes it is very difficult for us to say no. So then what God does is, God takes a toy away from us. So say, a mother wants to fondle the baby, but the baby is so caught with the toy that the baby doesn't pay any attention to the mother. And the mother takes away the toy. The mother takes the toy away, at that time, the baby is left with nothing. And then, you are there, O Lord. Oh mother, you are there. And the baby turns to the mother. So therefore it is said, Yasyaham anugrahanami harishyeta dhanam shanai tato dhanam tijatyasya svajana dukkha dukkhitaha. This is told in the 10th canto by Lord, the Lord Himself to the Pandavas. And this is what is demonstrated here in the story, that Yasyaham anugrahanami. So what the Lord says is that for those who are very devoted to Him, He shows special mercy by taking everything away. And He takes everything away, at that time the devotee is left with nothing except the Lord. Now here, what has happened to Bali Maharaj? So, initially Bali Maharaj is saying, I will act honorably, I will honor my word, I will give charity, and no matter what the cost, I will give charity. So initially, there is no explicit devotion over there. So how it is that, now because Bali Maharaj is born as a grandson of Prahlad Maharaj, there are devotional impressions within him. But those devotional impressions get lost. They get covered by the world. There is, say sometimes someone practices spiritual life for a good amount of time, but then they die. And their spiritual journey is not yet completed. They go into the next life. Now, when they go into this next life, no matter, I think this is enough. Do we need more?
No, we will take that thing right out and put this, so that it doesn't blind you.
I think this is okay. I don't mind it. Yeah, that's a good reminder. Yeah. So when the Lord takes everything away from a devotee, the point of that is the Lord wants to open the heart so that He can give Himself. Now, in the case of Prahlad Maharaj, at that time, Prahlad Maharaj has given spiritual impressions to Bali, but they are overcome. So I was talking about how somebody might be a very spiritually advanced soul, but when the baby is born, when that soul is born as a baby in the next life, now it's not that the baby is going to be born crying. The baby is not going to be born chanting Hare Krishna, no matter how spiritually evolved that baby might be. So, at that time, the baby will act according to the baby's nature, and as the baby grows up, they will act according to whatever nature of the society, the culture that is there. But below the socio-cultural, below the material is the spiritual. And that spiritual tendency will manifest at a particular point. What will be that particular point? That is the point when there is material disruption. See, as long as there is material order, then the way we are going on, we just keep going on that way. But when there is material disruption, at that time, the spiritual impression from the past life is what is reactivated. So that's what happens to Vritrasura. He's fighting like a demon against Indra, but when he sees the Astra of Vishnu right in front of him, about to destroy him, and he knows Vishnu's weapon can't be countered. So then, immediately that side of Vishnu's weapon and the imminence of death, the inevitability of death right in front of him, both of them combine to remind him of his previous life. And then you see there's a sudden difference in the speech of Ritarasura. He says at one point that, oh Indra, you are the murderer of your own brother. You are the murderer of your guru. You are the murderer of my brother. You are the murderer of a brahmana. You are the murderer of your guru. He says, you deserve to die and I will kill you. And then as he's speaking this, suddenly he says, if however, today you kill me, then I will give up this body and attain the abode of Mukunda. Till now there is no mention of the Supreme Lord, and suddenly he starts speaking praise of devotion. So what has happened is that spiritual trigger is activated. It's like there's a switch, and the switch is off, there is darkness. The switch turns on, there is light. So for all of us, we are all slowly practicing bhakti and we're trying to make spiritual advancement. But certain moments in our life will be like the switch turns on. And then suddenly everything becomes clear. And quite often for that switch to turn on, now there has to be disruption in our life as it is. So that disruption is not meant to destroy us, but the disruption is meant to elevate us. So another example to illustrate this point, that suppose there is a baby bird whose wings are developed, but the baby has never actually flown. And the baby is sitting, that the bird, which is no longer a baby, is grown reasonably, but the bird is sitting on a branch. And the bird might sit comfortably on the branch, but suddenly the branch under it breaks. And at that time, it will crash to its death. And suddenly, when we face a threat of life, at that time often, we discover power that we didn't know we had. Like when somebody feels threatened, they can fight back with such force. So at that time, the baby suddenly discovers, I have wings, and it starts flapping the wings, and the bird starts flying. So similarly, we are all like birds, and we are all sitting on various branches. Those branches are our material shelter. It might be our wealth, it might be our family, it might be our social status, it might be our talents. All these are like shelters, and they are like branches. While they are there, they are important for us. But these branches will break at some time or the other. And when the bad thing happens, we might say there is a principle of karma. When we do something bad comes upon us. When we do something good comes upon us. But whether good or bad, it all keeps us still within material existence. So, when sometimes the branch under us breaks, the purpose of that branch's breaking is not to make us crash to death. It is to make us activate our spiritualness. We're all souls, and we have spiritual inclinations. We have spiritual potential, and that needs to be activated. So sometimes when we do a good thing, like Mali Maharaj did a good thing, a very good thing in terms of sticking to his word of honor of giving charity. And it apparently Vishnu betrayed him. He did something good and God betrayed him. But God did not betray him. What God did was that he did a good thing, and he was so pleased that with him, that because you did a good thing, I will not just give you a good thing, I will give you a great thing. Now when you get a great gift, sometimes it doesn't appear that great. Initially it went away. What is this? What I have is being taken away from me. This branch which was my shelter is breaking. What's happening? But we needn't focus so much on the breaking of the branch as we can focus on the flapping of the wings. So if at that time we turn toward Krishna, and if we take shelter of Krishna, we will discover strength and shelter that we did not know we had. We will find in Krishna a sublime spiritual experience in the remembrance of Krishna, in praying to Krishna, in absorbing ourselves in Krishna. And that will help us rise above our situations. And if we discover the wings, we fly, and we'll fly during the course of our life till we find another branch. So during the course of our life, one branch will break, we need to fly till the next branch. Then after some time, that branch will break and we fly to another branch. And eventually a time will come when a branch breaks, our wings have become big enough so that we fly not to another branch, but fly high into the sky. We, by repeatedly exerting our wings, repeatedly turning toward Krishna and in shelter of Krishna, gradually our faith in Krishna will become stronger. Our attachment to Krishna will become deeper. Our absorption in Krishna will become greater. And as that happens, we will be strengthening our wings. And eventually, when finally the branch breaks under us, that means the time of our death comes. At the time of death, people leave home. Or rather, their bodies leave home. They're taken to the graveyard. At the time of death, devotees don't leave home. Devotees go home. Home is where the people whom we are most attached to are. And for a devotee who is most attached to the Lord, home is where the Lord is. And that is where a devotee goes after death. So when the Lord, when bad things happen to good people, rather than resenting that the bad things have happened, the good people turn toward God. They don't become resentful. Why is this happening to me? Ultimately that question is unanswerable. What is, why something is happening is just, there's just no way. If we take shelter of Krishna, we find that from whatever situation we are, we'll rise upwards and we will progress toward Krishna. Krishna's shelter is the greatest, the most empowering discovery that a soul can have in this world. The world can hurt us in many ways, but greater than the world's power to hurt is Krishna's power to heal. Greater than the world's power to hurt is Krishna's power to heal. So rather than resenting about why the world is hurting us so much, the Bhagavatam talks about the principle of karma, or it assumes karma as a background knowledge, but it doesn't stress karma. It says it's bhakti. Rather than asking why something is happening, ask, okay, how can I turn to God in this situation? How can I turn to Krishna and attain Krishna in this situation? And if we do this, no matter how bad the situation we are in, we'll find that there is some way ahead for us. So I'll conclude with three steps which each one of us can take to turn towards Krishna, no matter how bad the situation is, that how we can empower ourselves and how bhakti empowers us. This is, open a new tab in your life. Tab is T-A-B. Like if you are watching something on a computer and it's a horrible thing starts off, just open a new tab and see something else. So similarly, in our life, when everything seems to be horrible, in the world's tab, everything is horrible. So we open a new tab. Tab is three things: thoughts, attitude, and behavior. These three things are always in our power. No matter how many bad things happen to us, what we think about is always up to us. With what attitude we look at our life, look at the world, look at what is happening to us is up to us. And how we behave, that is also up to us. When we have problems, we don't need to think about the problems, but we don't have to keep thinking about those problems constantly. In fact, many times when we have a problem, the more we think about the problem, the bigger the problem seems to become. And then we feel burdened by that. So, okay, I have the problem, I acknowledge it. And like yesterday, I talked about wealth. Initially, below the poverty line, the more wealth increases, people seem to become happier. But beyond that, no matter how much wealth increases, it doesn't really lead to happiness. It depends on what people are doing with their wealth. So similarly, when we have a problem, we need to think about the problem a little bit so that we have some clarity. If you consider a graph of clarity versus time, and then the more we think about a problem, the clarity increases. Okay, I shouldn't do this, I should do this, do this, do this. But beyond a particular point, this graph flattens out. We keep thinking and no fresh insight comes. And after that, the graph goes down. The more we think about it, the more we feel burdened. So, when we talk about Krishna consciousness, thinking about Krishna, it is not about running away from the problems. It is ensuring that the problem doesn't run over us. I think about the problem as much as is constructive. And beyond that, just move on. Think about Krishna. Think about something else. So what we think about, the world can't control that. And especially if we develop the habit of cultivating Krishna, or cultivating the practices of Bhakti Yoga, then it will be easier for us to think of Krishna when the world puts us in trouble. If you are too attached to the world, then turning our thoughts from the world to Krishna will be difficult. But if you practice and develop attachment to Krishna, then thinking about Krishna will be easier. Then A is attitude. Attitude is, with what attitude do we look at the things that are happening to us? We can say that, oh, life is so terrible. Everybody betrays me. Nobody cares for me. Destiny is so unfair. We can have that attitude. Or we can have the attitude that bad things happen, but through the bad, God can bring the good also. So yes, this branch is breaking, but my wings are also opening. My wings are flapping, and my wings will be strong enough to take me to the next branch. So we can have the attitude that whatever happens, it may not be always good, but whatever happens, good can come from it. And let me do my part in it. So if we approach whatever happens positively means that not a naive, a Pollyannish positive thinking that, oh, everything is fine. Not like that. But even when bad things happen, by God's plan, something better will come from the bad. So there's an order, then suddenly chaos comes up. If the order is, the bird is sitting on the branch. The chaos is, the branch starts breaking. But then from that chaos, if the bird flaps its wings and flies, then what will happen is, the bird's wings will develop. The wings develop, at that time, it will become stronger. And then when it goes to the next branch, by the time it has become a stronger bird. So that attitude is that although bad things may happen, even from the bad, God can bring good. And with that spiritually positive attitude, we can find that we can have energy to move on. And the last thing, B, is behavior. How we behave in any situation is up to us. Sometimes some people fall sick and then they start becoming so irritable, so complaining, so grumpy, that they are sick and they make their caregiver sick of them. But, you know, when we are sick, yes, still maybe we can read something spiritual, hear something spiritual, whatever. It's small things we might be able to do. So we may feel, no, there's nothing I can do in this situation. That's not true. Now, no matter how bad things are, no situation ever takes away our power to make the situation worse. No matter how bad a situation is, no situation is so bad that it takes away our power to make it worse. I might have a fracture and I'm 6 weeks, I'm on the bed, I can't get up. I might say things can't become worse. No, while I'm on the bed, I can take a hammer and crack my other knee and fracture my other knee also. Isn't it? Obviously, I shouldn't. But the point I'm making is that if we have the power to make things worse, that means we have the power to make things better also. We are not as powerless as we think. So our behavior is always up to us. Our behavior, we may be able to only take small things. In whatever bad situation we are in, we can ourselves think. We can list easily two or three things that we are doing right now, which if we stop doing, things will at least not become worse. And we're not talking about big lifetime changes, which are very difficult. It's small things. We all can think of small things which we can do to stop making things worse. And conversely, we can think of some two, three things which we can do, which can make things better. And we start with those. So if we start with that, Krishna, I'm in this situation, I don't know what to do, but I want to serve you. Please guide me how I can serve you. Let me just maybe chant better, let me hear about Krishna better. Let me behave as well as I can. And if I, at least for the next 1 hour, let me not do anything which will make things worse. Yeah, 1 hour is doable. You do it, you find, yeah, you know, I did not make things worse. I did not make a mess of things. Then that itself, we can thank Krishna for giving us the strength to do that. We can appreciate ourselves, not in the egoistic sense, but in the encouraging sense. Good job. And more. So if we take small steps, then we will find that we can cover a significant distance even by that. Like we have a plan for our life, and it's like we are on a road and the street lights are all on. We can see the street lights fully ahead. And then suddenly the power goes off. And we are completely blinded. We had a plan for our life and one thing goes wrong and our whole life seems to be topsy-turvy now. At that time, what do? If the street lights go off, then we turn on our... We might moan, we might curse, we might grumble, but eventually we will take out our flashlight. Our phone's flashlight, if we turn on, it doesn't replace the street light. But it can show us one step ahead. And we take that one step, and that street light shows the next step. We take that one step and the street light shows us that next step. In this way, if we move on, then each one of us can continue even through the darkest periods in our life. And eventually we will come to light. That means the street lights will come back. When the street lights are there, it's like order. The street lights go off, there is chaos. But then again the street lights will come back. The bird will fly from one branch to another branch. So during that time, what is the flashlight that we can turn on? The flashlight is the service attitude. The question, Krishna, how can I serve you now? And just one step, what can I do right now? We can think in this situation that I am in for the next 1 hour, what is it that I can do that at least won't make things worse? That can make things better. And do it. That's like taking one step forward. One step forward. So Bali Maharaj actually did these things. And when this terrible thing happened, what was he doing? He was not filled with resentment. He dwelt on the fact that this is Vishnu. And all the bhakti that he had done, it was like a switch turned on. Initially, he was at the level of a kshatriya who wanted to honor his word. But when everything was taken away from him, when the branch under him broke, that's when his wings came out. Till that time, he was a rakshasa, he was an honorable rakshasa, he was an honorable kshatriya demon. But suddenly the devotion within him manifests. The branch breaks and his wings come out. So he thinks that this is Vishnu. And the attitude he takes is, Vishnu, nobody has ever punished anyone like this. But if Vishnu, you have done it, this is your mercy. And his behavior, what does he behave at that time? He says, he has nothing to offer, but he says, you take my head. And the Lord takes the head, and when the Lord puts his foot on the head, he actually blesses Bali Maharaj. So, although he could do nothing, he was bound at that time. But still, he did what he could. And if we do what we can, Krishna will do what we can't. But often we resent, why is this happening to me? Why is this happening to me? And we don't do what we can. And then, Krishna also says, okay, if you want to be resentful, then stay where you are. So if we just do what we can in our situation, just turn toward Krishna, pray to Krishna and do what we can in our situation, we'll find that Krishna will take us to a better place. Krishna will help us to evolve. We'll find that our spiritual wings will shelter us when our material shelters let us down. And that's how through the chaos, our faith in Krishna will increase and we will progress towards Him. That is what Bali Maharaj teaches. So, Vamana doesn't cheat Bali Maharaj of his wealth. Rather, Bali Maharaj's wealth is cheating Vamana of his spirituality. His attachment to his wealth is cheating him of his bhakti, of his devotion, of his love for God, which can give him eternal happiness. So Vamana cheats Bali to take away what has been cheating Bali. So the Lord actually does not cheat, the Lord rewards. And Bali Maharaj's extraordinary sacrifice in sticking to the truth, in honoring his word to the Lord is not in vain. It is rewarded, it is supremely rewarded. But it is not linearly rewarded. He does the action and immediately gets the reward. gets the action and suddenly in between something opposite happens. But he faithfully perseveres through that. And ultimately he gets an extraordinary reward. So I'll summarize what I spoke today. I spoke on the second part of when bad things happen to good people, what do they do? Talked about how Bali Maharaj, he gave a promise to honor his word and Vamana tricked him. The dwarf with two steps covered the whole universe. So God is not limited by his form because he is not limited to his form. He chooses to appear in a limited form for reciprocating love. But at any moment, he can expand into unlimited dimensions. Vamana becomes Trivikrama. And then, when this happens, this is so shocking that the demons try to intervene, but they are rendered powerless. And then the godly beings, Brahma and Prahlad, intervene. But apparently the Lord remains unrelenting. The Lord is waiting for what will Bali Maharaj say. And Bali Maharaj, he's not naive, he acknowledges that the way the Lord has acted with him can be grievous, is grievously wrong. He says, because you are doing it, O Lord, you cannot do any wrong. And then he says, I will honor my word to you. And he offers his own head. And then what happens? The Lord blesses him by putting his foot on his head and sends him to Sutala. So Indra gets the kingdom, but Bali gets the supreme king. And he gets the king as the doorkeeper of the king. So Vaman's mood is that, I stole your kingdom from you, but I will ensure that nobody will be able to steal anything from you. So when God gives us our desires, that's good. It's like a mother giving a crying baby a toy. But when the mother gives herself to her baby, it's like God giving himself to the devotee. And sometimes, if the toy is distracting us, God takes it away from us. So, we have spiritual potential because we are souls and we may have spiritual inclinations if we have practiced spirituality in our previous lives. But this is like the wings of a bird who has not discovered its wings till now. So, sometimes the branch under the bird has to break so that the bird discovers its wings. So, similarly, for us, the material situation that comfort us have to be disrupted for us to discover our latent spirituality. And when Krishna disrupts that for us, it can appear as if God is against us. But actually, God is for us. And if we keep flying with those wings, we'll fly at least to the next branch. And then the next branch, our wings will become stronger. And eventually, when the branch breaks, we'll fly all the way back to home. So those who are not devoted, they have to leave home at death. But those who are devoted, they leave for home. They attain the Lord. The world's power to hurt us is great. At any moment, the branches sheltering us can break. But greater than the world's power to hurt is God's power to heal. And for us to access the healing power of God, we need to stay with the service attitude. And for maintaining that service attitude, for us to fly from one branch to another, I talked about tab, that no matter how terrible the situation is, what was tab? T was? Thoughts. What we think about is always in our control. And if we have habituated ourselves to thinking about Krishna, then in thinking about Krishna, we will gain immense strength and solace even amidst our problems. We don't think about Krishna to run away from our problems. We think about Krishna so that the problems don't run over us. Thinking about a problem helps us get some clarity, but only up to a particular point. Overthinking takes away the clarity. Then A was attitude. When bad things happen to us, especially when we are doing good things, we can say, oh, life is so unfair. God is so unfair. Or we can say that the universe moves purposefully. There is some purpose. This is a bad thing that has happened, but through the bad, good can come. So, if we have that faith that if the branch is breaking, God will ensure that our wings will be strong enough to take us to the next branch. With that attitude, not everything is good, but a spiritually positive attitude based on God's faith, based on faith in God's power, God's plan and our spiritual potential. And then B was behavior. that how we behave is always in our control. When we feel powerless, we can think that, do I have the power to make things worse? We always have that. Then we also have the power to make things better. And just take small steps. When the street lights go off, just turn on the flashlight, take small steps. The small step is, Krishna, how can I serve you now? If we do that, we will be able to take one step forward. And just think, in the next 1 hour, what are two things that, if I won't do, things won't become worse. And what are things which I do, they can make become better. Just do this. Small steps. And if we take small steps in the mood of service to Krishna, we'll discover that we are far stronger than what we thought. And ultimately, Krishna will take us to the supreme safety and give us the supreme reward of His personal, His love for us, which will be our eternal treasure. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna. So, any quick questions? Okay. I can't see the face, I can only see the hand. Yes, so I can. Was there a hand here? Yes, Mantri.
Questions. One is that how to develop the sense of shelter on the Lord, even when we are sitting on the branch. We don't wait for the branch to
wait. Yes. Okay. So how do we get the sense that we need to take shelter of the Lord even while we are sitting on the branch? There are two aspects to it. Vidyamcha yastad vedo bhayam sah avidyaya mrityum tirtva Vidyaya Amritam Ashnuti. Upanishad says that we need knowledge of the material and knowledge of the spiritual, both, to grow beyond this material existence. So knowledge of the material means we need to regularly remind ourselves that this world is a temporary place, that the branch is going to break. It's not a question of if, it's only a question of when. So it's scary, but it doesn't have to be scary, it can be sobering. So, we need to regularly remind ourselves. That's why we need to hear spiritual classes, which also talk about the nature of the world. So that we are aware, and that creates a sense of urgency. But we don't want a fear-driven spirituality. We want a love-driven spirituality. That's why on one side we do hear about the temporary nature of the world, but we also need to hear about the loving nature of the Lord. And how, although our material shelter might be presently comfortable, we are meant for better than the comfortable. We are meant for something much more. So, in loving the Lord and in experiencing His love for us, there is eternal enrichment awaiting us. So, when we hear about the beauty of the Lord, about the glory of the Lord, about the loving dealings between Him and the Lord, by that our attraction to Him increases. And by both of these, by knowing that the branch under us will break, and by knowing that a better life awaits us, we can fuel ourselves. So, for both of these, the association of devotees is very important. To the extent we have association of devotees who are serious about developing their wings, to that extent, we will also get the urgency. Does that answer your question? Thank you. It's interesting. I can't see anything here. I can see something. Okay.
The second question is about Krishna during the pastime of fight, when he was fighting with Salva.
Okay, yeah, I remember you had asked this question yesterday. Yeah, I thought, why is it like this? This light is here. I didn't even know there's so many people sitting here. That's why I was looking at this side. Oh, okay, the simple reason. Oh, okay. Yeah, possible. So, now, the question is that there are times when the Lord seems to get bewildered. Like when Shalva comes and attacks Dwarka, at that time he creates an illusion that he has captured Vasudev, Krishna's father. And then he says, I will lop off the head of Vasudev. And he lops off the head. And Krishna is shocked at that time. So how can God be bewildered? See, the bhakti conception of God is thoroughly relational. Relational means that God does not delight in majestic isolation. That I exist above all of you and all of you bow down to me. That is not the mood in which God wants to live eternally. He wants to have the rich spectrum of relationships, which we also aspire for in this world. Actually, we aspire for it because we are parts of God, and God as a whole aspires for it in fullness. So that's why, although God is supreme in his own abode, he simply doesn't act as if he's supreme. He acts as the brother of someone, as the child of someone, as a friend of someone. And if he's a child of someone, his parents chastise him at times. And he accepts that chastisement. He takes on that role so that he can have the rich gamut of emotions that and emotional exchanges that come with various relationships with people in various roles. Now, in every relationship, there is also a very significant importance of vulnerability. Before I go to vulnerability, the point here is that God always remains God, but he takes on a role. This is the concept of Leela. He takes on a particular role to reciprocate love. So, within the Leela, whatever is required for enhancing the emotional exchanges in a particular relationship, he does that. So, as in any relationship, there is a need for vulnerability. The world is a tough place. It is brutally competitive. And that's why usually we all hide our weaknesses and we put on a front. It's like if you consider a boxing match, say a boxer just grazes the jaw of somebody, the other boxer, and the other boxer wins. Then the boxer knows, oh, he's got a weakness here, he's got a pre-existing wound over here. Then the other boxer will hit there itself repeatedly till this boxer collapses in pain. So the rule of the world is, it's ruthless. Hit where it hurts. So basically, in the world, we cannot afford to show our weak spots. We put on a front. But putting on a front can become tiring. You know, the heaviest burden is a mask. And sometimes the world forces us to put on a mask. So at least with the people whom we love, we want to take off the mask. And we want to admit our vulnerabilities. And if you find that in any relationship, there is no intimacy, then one very good way of developing intimacy is admitting vulnerability. Mm-hmm. That, you know, if imagine how this works. If you know somebody is a very competent person, very powerful person, who solves the problems of everyone, and they solve your problems also. But then one day, they tell you about the problems they are facing. They say, you know, this problem, I don't know how to deal with this. I'm worried about this. Now, if we are more like a fan of that person, we'll think, oh, I thought you were so great. You also have problems like me. We might be disillusioned. But actually, if you have a human appreciation of that person, we will see, oh, you trust me so much that you're telling this to me. So to take off our mask in front of someone indicates trust. So to admit vulnerability indicates trust. And admitting vulnerability brings intimacy. If parents find that their children are very distanced from them, instead of simply instructing the children, maybe the parents can admit vulnerability and say how during their teenage, how they went through difficulties. So sometimes admitting vulnerability is very important for fostering intimacy. So the Lord also acts as if he is vulnerable as a part of his Leela. He is never vulnerable, he is invulnerable, but he admits vulnerability. So although he is the provider of food for everyone, but sometimes he acts as if, oh mother, if you don't give me food, I'll die. And what the admission of vulnerability does is that it actually makes us feel needed in a relationship. We want to feel loved in the relationship, we want to feel well respected in the relationship, but we also want to feel needed in the relationship. So the Lord also gives his devotees the full gamut of experiences within the relationships. So he makes his mother feel needed. Hope, if I don't feed him, he will die. He will become weak, he will become sick, he may even die. And that increases the intensity of Mother Yashoda's absorption in him. So similarly, in a war, when the Lord acts as if he is bewildered, he is actually doing a leela in which he is admitting vulnerability. He is in a sense showing his intense attachment to his father. And he's showing that, if my father dies, even I get bewildered. It's normal when somebody very close to us dies. And it's one thing to die after a long sickness where you get time to prepare for the inevitable departure of the loved person. But it's another thing to see right in front of you somebody being butchered and you rendered helpless to stop. So it is an overwhelming thing. And when the Lord acts as if he's bewildered over there, he's actually showing how much he cares. And of course, then what do they think? Hey, this can't be. I had put Balram for guarding Dwarka, and Balram would not allow Shalva to go inside. So here also, what he's saying? He's saying that even if I was not able to save, Balram would have saved. So again, he is admitting his vulnerability, his dependence. And as he's intensifying the flavor of sweetness in his relationships. So this is a part of a leela, and the Lord getting bewildered might seem like a dushana, but it is actually a bhushana. It is not a contamination, it is an ornamentation, which shows how personal and personable the Lord as revealed in the bhakti tradition is. Does that answer your question? Thank you. One last question, you had something here? Or has the question now disappeared from here? I can't see also. Okay, professor, so we'll stop here. So thank you very much. Grantharaj Srimad Bhagavatam ki, Srila Prabhupada ki, Gaur Bhakta Vrinda ki, Gaur Premanande.